الله والله 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 الله والله والله والله
الذين يستمعون القول فيتبعون أحسنه
الحمد لله الحمد لله ثم الحمد لله الحمد لله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله الودود الحليم الحمد لله القائل في كتابه الكريم نبئ عبادي أني أنا الغفور الرحيم وأن عذابي هو العذاب الأليم وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن سيدنا محمدًا عبده ورسوله وصفيه من خلقه وخليله أرسله بالحق بشيرًا ونذيرًا وداعيًا إلى الله بإذنه وسراجًا منيرًا اللهم صلِّ وسلِّم وبارك عليه وعلى آله الطيبين الطاهرين وارض اللهم عن صحابة رسول الله أجمعين واجعلنا اللهم ممن أحبهم وحشر معهم يوم القيامة بمنك وكرمك يا أكرم الأكرمين وأوصيكم ونفسي بتقوى الله فاتقوا الله عباد الله قال الله سبحانه وتعالى يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله ولتنظر نفس ما قدمت لغد واتقوا الله إن الله خبير بما تعملون أما بعد أحبتي في الله my dear respected imams, elders, brothers, sisters and loving children Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala manifests His mercy all the time and a special mercy is manifested in the month of Ramadan This morning, I don't even say last night, just after midnight one of the brothers messaged me on Facebook and he asked me a few questions the first question was rather humorous because he sees me leading Salah somewhere at Rosedale Mosque. So he says, are you a Sheikh? I said, well, I'm not that old because Sheikh means old. وَأَبُونَ شَيْخٌ كَبِيرٌ as Allah says in the Quran. But if you ask me about religious training, yes, I am. Alhamdulillah, I have my training and authorization. So he said, look, obviously he sent me a friend request. And I saw what the brother looks like. And I don't want to go into detail, but I think we can relate to this. There are certain brothers, when you look at, you might start to judge them from the past. And I leave it to your imagination because we have to be discreet and conceal, you know, the past of people. He said, you can see my photo, obviously. And I feel bad about what I did in the past. And I just started to repent. He was raised as a Muslim. He was born as a Muslim. But obviously, like many of us at times, we have our weaknesses. And at the time of weakness, you forget about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he said, the month of Ramadan struck me and I've repented to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and I'm trying so hard and it's so sweet to be obedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Yes, indeed it is. So one of the questions that he asked after listing a number of sins that he committed was, will Allah forgive me? Subhanallah. And I said to myself that you're not the only person who need to ask this. We also have to ask the same thing. Because we can never judge people. A person can turn from zero to hero, from a sinner into a saint. And the Quran is full of ayat which we'll talk about in a minute. But that made me realize before I answer this question that how many of us, including myself, we are clothed with the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That we sin, and again I'm not being general, I'm talking about myself because mashallah there are many of you who are pious and God fearing, like one of the salihin, one of the pious said, إِنِّي مِنْ ذُنُوبِي فِي يَقِينَ أَوْ عَلَى يَقِينَ وَمِنْ ذُنُوبِي إِخْوَانِي فِي شَكٍ When it comes to my own sins, I am absolutely certain. But when it comes to the sins of others, I have doubt. Therefore, I can be certain about myself and I can be in doubt of the sins of others. That made me think of the rahmah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, how He conceals us. There are beautiful couplets of poetry where the poet says, وَاللَّهِ لَوْ عَلِمُوا قَبِيحَ سَرِيرَتِي لَأَبَى السَّلَامَ عَلَيَّ مَنْ يَلْقَانِي وَلَأَعْرَضُوا عَنِّي وَمَلُّوا صُحْبَتِي وَلَبُؤْتُ بَعْدَ كَرَامَةٍ بِهَوَانِي لَكِنْ سَتَرْتَ مَعَايِبِي وَمَثَالِبِي وَحَلِمْتَ عَنْ سَخَطِي وَعَنْ طُغْيَانِي فَلَكَ الْمَحَامِدُ وَالْمَدَائِحُ كُلُّهَا بِخَوَاطِرِي وَجَوَارِحِي وَلِسَانِي. He says, if people only knew about my inward, then nobody would have greeted me. They would have shunned me, they would have turned away from me. And after all the honor I received, I will be abased. وَلَأَعْرَضُ عَنِّي وَمَلُّ صُحْبَتِي وَلَبُؤْتُ بَعْدَ كَرَامَةٍ بِهَوَانِي. May Allah protect us. Then he says, لَكِنْ وَاللَّهُ سَتَرْتَ مَعَايِبِي. You are the one who clothed me with this. You concealed my shortcomings and my sins. وَحَلِمْتَ عَنْ سَطَطِي وَعَنْ طُغْيَانِي. And Ya Allah, you are so forbearing. You are so patient with me. الصبور. You gave me time, you gave me respite. Therefore I say, Ya Allah, as the poet says, فَلَكَ الْمَحَامِدُ وَالْمَدَالِحُ كُلُّهَا. I can only thank you and praise you, Ya Allah, in whatever way possible. بِخَوَاطِرِي وَجَوَارِحِي وَلِسَانِي. In my thoughts, in my limbs, and on my tongue. I can only display my gratitude to you, Ya Allah. Another one says, يَظُنُّونَ بِخَيْرًا وَمَا بِخَيْرٌ ولكنني عبد ظلوم كما تدري سترت عيوبي كلها عن عيونهم وألبستني ثوبا جميلا من الستر فصاروا يحبونني وما أنا بالذي يحب ولكن شبهوني بالغير فلا تفضحني في القيامة بينهم وكل يا مولاي في ساعة الحشر. He said, people think good of me because of what I do, because how I dress, because of what I talk. For different reasons. وَمَا بِخَيْرٌ. I know the reality. I'm not really worthy of this. وَلَكِنَّنِي عَبْدٌ ظَلُومٌ. I'm only a transgressing servant. Because when we sin, that is ظُلُم against ourselves as well. When you're in a state of ma'asiyah, disobedience, you are harming yourself first. There's that enjoyment of the disobedience, but as soon as it's over, then the reality kicks in and you feel, oh my God, what have I done to my soul? وَلَكِنَّنِي عَبْدٌ ظَلُومٌ كَمَا تَدْرِي. Ya Allah, you know how transgressing I am. You conceal my shortcomings from them. And you clothe me, وَأَلْبَسْتَنِي ثَوْبًا جَمِيلًا مِنَ السِّتْرِ. You clothe me with these beautiful clothes of concealing, concealment. فَصَارُوا يُحِبُّونَنِ. People, then you put love of me in the people's hearts. وَمَا أَنَا بِالَّذِي يُحَبُّ وَلَكِنْ شَبَّهُونِيَ بِالْغَيْرِ. The reality, I know myself, Ya Allah, it's your mercy that they start to love me. And if people love you and accept you, it's one of the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I go to this hadith, where the famous hadith, when Allah loves someone, He tells Jibreel alayhi salam to call in the heavens that Allah loves so and so you love him. فَيُوضَعُ لَهُ الْقَبُولُ فِي الْأَرْضِ. Allah gives him acceptance, gives him or her acceptance, divine acceptance from people. Then he says, this poet, we come back, and he says, فَصَارُوا يُحِبُّونَنِي وَمَا أَنَا بِالَّذِي يُحَبُّ وَلَكِنْ شَبَّهُونِيَ بِالْغَيْرِ. I bring these good examples, hence people like me. But the reality is, I remind him of good things. Then he says, فَلَا تَفْضَحْنِي فِي الْقِيَامَةِ بَيْنَهُمْ. This is the crux of the matter. This is the most important thing. Oh Allah, you've concealed me in this life. Please, Ya Allah, do not expose me on the day of judgment. وَكُلِّيَ يَا مَوْلَايَ فِي سَاعَةِ الْحَشْرِ. Oh my Lord, my sustainer, my creator, my caretaker. To take me and help me. You've helped me in this world. Please help me on the day of Qiyamah. So my answer to this brother, I said, absolutely yes. And nobody can give judgments, by the way. We don't give tickets to Jannah or Jahannam. We all know the hadith where the Prophet ﷺ said, لَنْ يَدْخُلَ أحد الجنة بعمله، وفي رواية لن يدخل أحد الجنة عمله. قال ولا أنت يا رسول الله؟ قال ولا أنا إلا أن يتغمدني الله برحمة منه وفضل. No one will go to Jannah through their deeds. Because if you compare our deeds to what Allah gives us, it's like buying a mansion for $5. It's not really, it doesn't make any sense. Hence in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah An-Naba, when he talks about the punishment of the criminals, he says, جَزَاءً وِفَاقًا. It is the consequences of what they did. Then when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about what he prepared for the pious, إِنَّ لِلْمُتَّقِينَ مَفَازَ حَدَائِقَ وَعَنَابًا, all the great things that Allah prepared for the pious, he ends it subhanahu wa ta'ala by saying, جَزَاءً مِنْ رَبِّكَ عَطَاءً حِسَابًا. This is a gift from your Lord. It's a gift from him. He doesn't say because of what they did. Because it can never be enough. So the Prophet said, no one will go to Jannah with their deeds, including me, until and unless Allah showers me with his mercy and bounty. So I said to this brother, there are ayat in the Quran. I said, look my brother, I want to share with you a few ayat from the Quran. And you compare your sins to the sins that are mentioned in these ayat. And then you have hope. We can't say certainty. We can never be certain. Like it's been, يعني أثير عن سيدنا أبي بكر رضي الله عنه that he said, if my right foot is in Jannah and the left one is outside, ما أمنت مكر الله. I would not take it for granted. يا مقلب القلوب والأبصار ثبت قلوبنا على دينك. Allah is the turner of the hearts. We don't know. It's all His will subhanahu wa ta'ala. So I said those ayat ending of Surah Al-Furqan where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about major sins. والذين لا يدعون مع الله إلها آخر ولا يقتلون النفس التي حرم الله إلا بالحق ولا يزنون. Those who do not associate partners with Allah. Allah is describing عباد الرحمن, the servant of the most gracious subhanahu wa ta'ala. So some of their qualities are this. They do not associate partners with Allah. They do not kill others without a legitimate cause. And they do not commit zina, fornication. وَمَنْ يَفْعَلْ ذَلِكَ يَلْقَ أَثَامًا. Allah is so stern about it. He says, any person who commits this major sin, then there is severe punishment waiting for him or her. يُضَاعَفْ لَهُ الْعَذَابِ. It will be multiplied for them. And they will be in it for eternity. إِلَّا مَنْ تَابَ. Allah, Allah. Except the one who تَابَ, repented, وَآمَنَ, وَعَمِلَ عَمَلًا صَالِحًا. فَأُولَٰئِكَ يُوَدِّلُ اللَّهُ سَيِّئَاتِهِمْ حَسَنًا. وَكَانَ اللَّهُ غَفُورًا رَحِيمًا. From such, as I said, like being the worst of the worst, the scum of the earth, into being all this bad credit, being turned into good credit. Literally, يُبَدِّلُ اللَّهُ سَيِّئَاتِهِمْ حَسَنَاتٍ. Allah changes the bad deeds into good deeds. If we can take it literally, معنى الحقيقي. SubhanAllah. So I said to him, I leave it to you and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the other ayat that I wanted to reflect on, I haven't even started the topic of Jum'ah today. Anyway, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Al-Zumar, Surah number 39, I thought of this ayat after we stopped the chatting because it was very late. And I said, may Allah help us to wake up for suhoor. It's so late now. I mean, you can't pray all night and miss Fajr Salah. It doesn't make much sense. Those ayat, and I could not sleep before thinking of this ayat. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Al-Zumar, Surah number 39, the ayat is number 53, where He says subhanahu wa ta'ala, قُلْ يَا عِبَادِيَ الَّذِينَ أَسْرَفُوا عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِهِمْ لَا تَقْنَطُوا مِنْ رَحْمَةِ اللَّهِ إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَغْفِرُ الذُّنُوبَ جَمِيعًا إِنَّهُ هُوَ الْغَفُورُ الرَّحِيمُ. I said, I wish I quoted those ayat to him because they're more powerful. Instead of listing certain sins, because this ayah includes every sin you could think of. Allah says, قُلْ say to my servants. Allah did not abandon them. Did not abandon us despite our transgression. قُلْ يَا عِبَادِي, my servants. الَّذِينَ أَسْرَفُوا عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِهِمْ, those who have transgressed against themselves, ظُلُمْ, against oneself. We don't deserve this misery of disobedience. لا تقنطوا من رحمة الله. Don't give up with the mercy of Allah. Why? إن الله يغفر الذنوب جميعا. Allah will give all the sins. Not 10%, 20%, 30%, 100%. إِنَّهُ هُوَ الْغَفُورُ الرَّحِيمُ. Indeed, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is, that is His attribute. He is al-ghafoor. He is the all-forgiving, the all-merciful subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then the rest of the ayat, of course, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us direction. وَأَنِيبُوا إِلَىٰ رَبِّكُمْ وَأَسْلِمُوا لَهُ مِنْ قَبْلِ أَنْ يَأْتِيَكُمُ الْعَذَابُ ثُمَّ لَا تُنْصَرُونَ. Turn unto your Lord in repentance and submit unto Him before the punishment comes to you, and then there will be no help available for you. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow us and enable us to repent to Him. Now if we listen to a khutbah or a talk or something, we get uplifted or pumped up spiritually, and I want to repent and I want to become a muttaqi, and after that we slip, we must not give up. This is the nature of insan. The hadith, وَالَّذِي نَفْسِي بِيَدِهِ in the Sahih Imam Muslim, لَوْ لَمْ تُذْنِبُوا لَذَهَبَ اللَّهُ بِكُمْ وَأَتَى بِقَوْمٍ يُذْنِبُونَ فَيَسْتَغْفِرُونَ فَيَغْفِرُهُمْ. Had you not sinned, Allah would have wiped you out. He would have brought a people who would sin and seek His forgiveness, and He will forgive them. This is not encouraging sinning, by the way. But this is, it's the nature of the son of Adam to sin. And it is Allah's attribute to forgive. How would you experience the forgiving, al-ghaffar, al-ghafoor, if you don't commit sins? Again, it's not an encouragement, by no means. But it's an encouragement to always repent. Just like clothes. When your clothes get dirty, you go and wash them. You don't say, okay, I washed them once, let me wear them for another year or something. Repentance, and the Prophet used to tell us to make repentance every day. Ya ayyuhan nasu tubu ila Allahi wastaghfiru. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala enable us to have this attitude that we come back to Him every day. And it's something that has come to mind right now, and I really want to share it with you. Where one of the aphorisms, a great man of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he was a spiritual master who said, Rubba, and this is really, really, it can be contentious and easily misunderstood, so I'm going to tread very carefully. He says, Rubba, ma'asiyatin, awrata, dhullan, wastisghara, khayrun min ta'atin, awrata, izzan, wastikbara. Allahu Akbar. Is it perhaps an act of disobedience that will inherit the person an attitude of humiliation before Allah, an absolute need for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is better than an act of obedience that will inherit the person who does it an attitude of pride and arrogance? Because the sinner who knows that he or she has sinned and they need the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is way better than the obedient person who thinks, now that's it, I'm the man, I'm the woman, I can do it, others don't do it. And they judge, and then at the end of the day, their judgment lead them to the hellfire. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. And the hadith I think of right now is the sahabi who had the weakness, I mentioned it yesterday before Taraweeh. And it's the hadith in Bukhari. The sahabi who had the weakness of drinking wine. He was an addict. And every time they bring him, because when he commits a sin openly, they have to apply the penalty. Obviously, the community, the Islam is the system of that community. And once, when they punished him, one of the Sahaba felt at liberty, and many of us do at times, to judge that person. He cursed him. And the Prophet said, لا تلعنه. Don't you dare curse him. And then what comes next really is mind-boggling. He said, أَمَا عَلِمْتَ أَنَّهُ يُحِبُّ اللَّهَ وَرَسُولَهُ. Do you not know that this man loves Allah and His Messenger? The one who judged did not get that testimony of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But the one who sinned, the one who's an addict, got such a testimony from the one whom Allah says about, وَمَا يَنطِقُ عَنِ الْهَوَىٰ إِنْ هُوَ إِلَّا وَحْيٌ يُوحَىٰ. He does not say words from his own desire. It's only a revelation that comes to him. Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us to repent to him and to always be in a state of obedience and in a state of tawbah if we sin. Ameen ya Rabbal Alameen. Our topic for today, the Jum'ah is almost over, about taqwa. And perhaps I'll share with you something very fast about taqwa. Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Umar did a social experiment back then. There are many social experiments that you watch on YouTube, and I think they give us a good insight into the society. But that was done centuries ago. The social experiment was that he went to a shepherd and he said, give me one of the sheep. Some of you may have heard the story already. And the man said, I am only a mamluk, وليست لي. I'm a slave, it doesn't belong to me. And I'll say it in English so we can have time, inshallah. So Abdullah ibn Umar gave him an excuse. He said, you know, say to the owner, أكلها الذئب, it was eaten by a wolf. So he said, if I say this to the owner of the sheep, what am I going to say to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? What am I going to say to Allah? ماذا أقول إذا نطقت الجوارح والأركان? When the day comes, when I will have no option but for my organs and my limbs to speak on my behalf. In Surah Yasin, we all recite this. اليوم نختم على أفواههم. Today, they just, we conceal their mouths. وتكلمنا أيديهم. Their hands will talk to us. وَتَشْهَدُ أَبْجُلُهُمْ بِمَا كَانُوا يَنْسِبُونَ. Their feet, their legs will testify against them for what they used to do. So Abdullah ibn Umar was so touched by this level of taqwa, consciousness, being spiritually aware of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that he set him free. And he said to him, you've said this word in this dunya, and it freed you from slavery. May Allah free you through this word on the day of judgment. The social experiment was repeated in Saudi Arabia. And do me a favor, do yourselves a favor, and especially the children as well. On YouTube, it's called Taqwa of a Sheep Herder. Right? It's very easily accessed. So they go to this shepherd in the out, like nowhere, in the desert. These two brothers, I don't know if they were sheikhs or whatever. I think they were also conducting a social experiment. So they go to him, and he's from Sudan, by the way. And subhanallah, you look at him and say, who is this man? Some of us, we judge by appearances. You look at him, you know, he's just an ordinary man. But in his heart, he was an absolute, as far as I'm concerned, a saint. وَلَا أُزَكِّي عَلَى اللَّهِ أَحَدًا. I'm not casting judgments, absolutely. So they said to him, give us a sheep. He said, it's not mine, I can't give it to you. He said, come on, in the Saudi colloquial Arabic, he said, you know, you tell the owner that it got lost. He said to him, what about the shibr, the palm length? He said, what do you mean? He said, my grave. What am I going to say there? He said, come on, take it easy. Nobody will know. We're not going to tell anybody. He didn't know that they were taping him. Then they were trying harder with him, and then they said to him, you know, we'll give you 200 riyals. Which is about 70 Australian dollars. So he said to him, before that, he said, wallahi, if the heaven falls on the earth, I will not give it to you. Then he said, 200 riyals, even if you give me 200,000 riyals, which is 70,000 Australian dollars. So the guy says, but are you happy? Look at you, look at your life, man. He said, look, as long as I'm earning from halal, I'm happy. I have my peace of mind. And that is something that is priceless. As they say in English, you can have everything and have nothing. And you can have nothing but have everything. If you have peace of mind. ليس الغنى عن كثرة العرض إنما الغنى غنى النفس كما قال عليه الصلاة والسلام. True riches within the heart, contentment. So they let him go. Now what I want to report on this shepherd, obviously the story went everywhere. And they ended up giving him 200,000 riyals. $70,000, and mashallah, he's been honored in this life, obviously, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala honor him in the hereafter. This is something applicable, and I want to say that even if he didn't get the $70,000, to me, and I'm sure many of you will agree with me, that feeling that you were able to resist the temptation when nobody is watching, that feeling is priceless. Not even the money of the world can compensate for that feeling. Like when you give someone, they say, in the giving there is receiving. I don't have to get anything physical. I've already got that feeling. So the concept of taqwa, as I said last Jum'ah, that is nurtured in Ramadan, cultivated in Ramadan, is applicable to many areas in our life. For example, when we go to work, sign in at 8 o'clock, for example. I remember years ago, I was working somewhere, and I used to see some of my colleagues, one in particular, who would sign out, he would write down the 3:30, but he would leave by 3:15. Now halal is not just going to the butcher down the road and buying halal meat. Alhamdulillah, I eat halal, but 15 minutes I stole it from that person. And that's a bigger concept of halal. Being conscious of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the ability to be conscious of Him all the time. The word taqwa in Arabic means wiqaya, that you protect yourself. And in Islam or in the terminology, and تَجْعَلَ بَيْنَكَ وَبَيْنَ عَذَابِ اللَّهِ وِقَايَةً, to protect yourself from the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and staying away, take precautions to stay away from the things that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala prohibits. The ayat of taqwa begin with كُتِبَ عَلَيْكُمُ الصِّيَامُ كَمَا كُتِبَ عَلَى الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ. The main purpose of fasting is for us to achieve taqwa, and it is achievable in the month of Ramadan, and we can continue inshallah after the month of Ramadan. If we slip, we remember that Allah Ghafurun Raheem subhanahu wa ta'ala, He is all forgiving, all merciful, and obviously His punishment is severe as well, as we said in the beginning of the khutbah. But if we repent to Him, the Prophet said in a hadith by Ibn Majah and others, At-ta'ibu min al-dhanbi kaman la dhanba lah. A person who repents from a sin, from committing a